It's pretty exciting to be here. I'm actually, the transition from Alex's last slides are perfect. And I have to say, I can't think of a better way to follow children than to have animals. So had to have some animals for you. In fact, greetings from Texas A&M. And this is my dog. And by the way, today I've been texting all day because he has a tumor and they aspirated it. So while I'm sitting in the audience, I'm monitoring my patient's health, my own dog's health. So it is Convergence of Frontiers in Veterinary and Human Medicine. There's a whole lot to talk about. And what I want to do is do a teaser over a waterfront and not go into a lot of depth on any one thing. So stand back, and I promise I'm going to speak faster than Daniel Kraft, so don't worry. But we are all in a transformative age, and this is affecting all of us everywhere. And certainly the impact on health, we all know. I don't need to say a thing about that. But human and veterinary medicine are so closely aligned, and there are ways that we can help each other out so much and drive a lot of these initiatives forward that we really need to be working together as much as we can. And if you look at the topics, all of these, you could put exponential veterinary medicine topics, and they all apply, and we're all working on the same ones. Some of them we're behind on, some of them we're ahead on. It just depends on what it is. So what I wanted to do is break this down into three parts. One is the role of animals in society. The other is global one health, sharing the planet, and then some mutually advancing healthcare efforts that we're doing. So role of animals in society. All right, they surveyed fifth graders, and they said, what are the most important issues in the world? You know what they said? Welfare of animals. All right, so number two and number three were protecting the environment and caring for people. What can I say? And when you add to that, that these are now 21-year-old, this was done in 2009, and so now these are 21-year-old Generation Zs who are entering the workforce, and they're people that you work with a lot now, and this is how they feel. And so the societal views of animals are certainly changing, and they're changing dramatically, and they're calling them fur kids now, and they're calling them pet parents. And some of the millennials are choosing pets as starter families and some as even permanent families, to the point that it's affecting Pampers sales. So just so you know. And when you ask a millennial about grandchildren today, you might get this. And so they are changing. And in a survey, 23% of those surveyed said they love their dog more than their significant other. Now, what I want to remind you of is that's 23% of you in this audience, and that's 23% of your patients or with whom you work. And when I told this to my son, he said, you know, Mom, he said, that doesn't take into consideration the 50% who are undecided. So, in other words, pets, animals are important to us, and the ownership, again, 68% of you have a pet, 68% of your patients have a pet, and y'all spend a lot of money on these animals. And if you came, if you flew in Southwest, this was the cover of their October 2019 magazine. So that's interesting, but does it really matter? And the fact is, it does matter. And there is a foundation called the Human-Animal Bond Research Initiative. And what this does is try to document the benefits of animals to people in a very important way. So if you watch this for a minute.
Discover relief from fatigue, depression, and stress. Discover Dog. Prescription strength Dog is the non-harmful treatment that is shown to lower blood pressure and risk of heart disease, prevent allergies in children, reduce stress levels, decrease anxiety and depression, strengthen your immune system, and increase social interaction. Side effects may include talking in ridiculous dog voices, picking up poop, making funny faces, being jealous of your dog kissing other people, pretending your dog has a job and has to pay rent, excessive social media posts, laying on the floor pretending to die to see if your dog comes to help you, having full-on discussions with your dog, feeling guilty if you don't tell your dog you love them before you leave the house, saying bless you when your dog sneezes, calling your dog by names other than its actual name, congratulating your dog's bowel movements. Discover better health. Ask your veterinarian about Dog.
So it's true, it's documented. And if you look even at mental health, the human-animal interactions reduce anxiety and depression and loneliness, and they enhance social support and general well-being, generally speaking. And so we could use these animals for prescription for depression. And my brother is a psychiatrist, and I told him about this, and he said, I'm not sure I would do it to the dog or the pup or the kitten or the puppy. But anyway, it is something that truly has documented effects. It certainly takes into consideration social isolation isolation and loneliness. It improves connections, it provides social support, and it decreases loneliness and depression. Had the first ever summit in social isolation and companion animals in May of this year in DC. And it's been shown, and these are all documented studies, to decrease in depression in elderly residents of nursing home when there's a resident dog there, depression and grief in children. And I gave a talk on the human-animal bond once, and children were supposed to draw a picture of what that meant to them. And I want to show you this one in the center. I blew it up. And it says, when the world leaves you, they never will. Often children will turn to a pet in times of grief and loneliness when they won't share with an adult. So they have a lot of documented benefits. Alzheimer's patients, they smile and laugh more. They're less hostile, more socially communicative. Children with autism, same effects, calmer, better concentration, reduced stress. Psychiatric patients, a significant increase in interaction with other patients compared to those whenever there's an animal there. Post-traumatic stress disorder, huge here. Animals are extremely important for PTSD. And there are a lot of these warriors who tell us that they won't get out of their house, but once they get a service dog, they will. And it totally changes their life. They miss less work. They interact more. Documented benefits of pets to people. And it's also been shown for those who are in other situations, like the homeless, that it's not only companionship, but it's safety. And they'll feed that dog before they'll feed themselves. So very important in the human-animal bond. Cancer patients, you all know this. Animal-assisted therapy has a tremendous number of benefits, all listed here, but documented benefits all through research projects. Cancer patients, pediatric, animal-assisted therapy has all sorts of positive benefits that you see here, including helping the parents and the child in coping and facilitating their coping mechanisms during this trying time in their lives. Cancer detection. Dogs also can detect cancer, and the sensitivity and specificities are very high in these trials in dogs. Allergies and immunity, the tape showed that, but there's a very positive impact of early exposure on the development of allergies and asthma later in life. And teenagers who live with a cat have 48% lower risk of cat allergies than others. Prenatal exposures can influence their immune development, which is also, again, proven. So research shows that pets are good for the heart. The American Heart Association has shown many benefits, including lower systolic blood pressure and other parameters. I love this one. Owning a cat, one's more likely to be alive 1 year after a heart attack. So if you have a heart attack, go out and get a cat, for heaven's sakes. It's going to be really important for your which group you're in. So hospitalized patients with heart failure, also with very little interaction with pets, all their cardiac parameters are improved. So really helps there. And to the point, this is so well documented now, and the evidence is growing and growing, that the NIH is now saying that studies of humans have to take into consideration now whether there's a pet in the home, because otherwise there may be variables that may cloud the results. So another important point. So they're prescriptions for life, and that's important. Now, certainly they benefit those, but another thing we need to know is that dogs went from the barnyard to the house to the bedroom, and it's not just dogs, it's a lot of different animals that now live in our homes, and they share our environments with us. And so in these shared environments, we're exposed to many of the same things. So the risk factors affect the people and they affect the animals. So smoking certainly is one. And so, you know, if you smoke, I smoke, we smoke, and the same effects can happen in the animals and in the people. And we are seeing more cases of marijuana toxicosis now than we've ever seen before in animals. So risk factors in the home. And so with these shared environments, it's foodborne disease we share, all sorts of infections and other things that are the same. Certainly, we interact in different ways, but we do share diseases. There's no doubt about that. And dogs can transmit to people, but we have to remember that people can transmit to dogs too. We kind of always want to blame the animals, but you know what? We're important in the equation, and it goes both ways. So that leads right into the second part, which is global One Health, sharing the planet. And Dr. Gerald Parker will talk about this tomorrow a little bit more. But what this means, global One Health, is a term which I hope everybody is going to be aware of and responds to in very little time. It's been around for a while. It's the inextricable link between animal, human, and environmental health. And that's from local to global. Question, why do we vaccinate our dogs? We think to vaccinate to protect the dog. It's to protect the whole family, isn't it? And rabies is still a prevailing disease globally and is certainly a threat. Another one, I just want to give just one disease example here. Chagas disease, number one cause of infectious cardiomyopathy in the world. It's incurable and it's migrating northward. And if you look at Texas and you look at the incidence in dogs and people, boy, you could set those graphs right over each other and there you see it. And so what we're doing some work at Texas A&M, we developed an app. People send us pictures or mail in bugs and kissing bugs. 60% of the kissing bugs in Texas are infected. That is a human health risk. That is an animal risk. And so these dogs can be sentinels for human disease as well. We don't have any evidence yet that it's transmitted between dogs and people, but there's more to learn, and we just don't know that yet. And the dogs show clinical signs that are very similar to people. This is a family. This is some boxers that came into our clinic, and they had evidence of right-sided heart failure that was indistinguishable from what happens in people, and you can see the organisms there in the myocardium. So now we're looking at tracing these dogs in border protection circumstances so we can get a better handle on that. Okay, another one, zoonotic diseases. 60% of known infectious diseases are zoonotic. In other words, transmitted between animals and people. And 75% of the new and emerging infectious diseases are zoonotic. Every 4 months, a new infectious zoonotic disease emerges that originates in animals. This is something that we all need to be concerned about, not just veterinarians, not just human healthcare professionals, but all of us in this country. And if you look at some of these serious emerging and infectious diseases that are devastating, in fact, many of them have their origins in animals. Not all, but most of them do. And everything from camels to fruit bats to rats to whatever it is, it's not just one animal that's involved. So this is Dr. Gerald Parker, and we have at Texas A&M, we have an awareness of the next pandemic, and we have these pandemic summits to look at this, and we work with the Scowcroft Institute at the Bush School of Government, and we've had three of these so far. The first looked at growing threats of pandemics, the next at global leadership, and then last year we looked at community leadership and collaboration. Emphasis on collaboration. This is where we have to work together for the benefit of this world that we have in this shared environment. And this year, just coming up in very short order, is the fifth annual Global Pandemic Summit, and it's on pandemic and biosecurity threats in the 21st century. What are we looking at, and what can we do to mitigate? So very important. And Dr. Parker also spends a lot of time talking in D.C. to legislators, and he's talked to the Blue Ribbon Panel on Biodefense on many occasions. And I'm very proud to say that for the first time ever, the 2018 National Biodefense Strategy had the elements of Global One Health. It's humans, animals, plants, and the environment. First time ever, and this is where we need to be going. Pretty excited about that. I want to give you an example of Ebola virus. Do you remember when Mr. Duncan got Ebola in Dallas, Texas, right? And so when they went, and then Nina Pham was a healthcare worker who then also showed the clinical signs and was shown to have Ebola. And so when they went to clean her apartment and disinfect it, guess what? She had a dog, Bentley, and I'm sure he's a nationally known dog now. But what do you do? We didn't know what to do with the dog. If you touched him, were you going to be infected? Was he shedding? Was he carrying? Was he a fomite? Was he truly shedding a virus? So what was the deal there? And I know that in Spain, when this woman contracted Ebola, they killed her dog summarily, and she did survive, and she said afterwards that losing her dog was more important than having Ebola. And so you have to take care of this. So what we did at Texas A&M is we deployed our veterinary emergency team. They stayed with this dog in isolation for 21 days. Collecting samples all the way through. And in the end, this dog was healthy, everything was fine, and they were reunited. So again, working together is what we need to be doing. And as you know now, we are in the middle of the second largest Ebola outbreak on record. And now they've had to actually suspend the screenings at the border because of danger. But this is something we need to address together. Antimicrobial resistance, hugely important to all of us. This is something, again, we need to be working on together. And I love this graph. I looked at a lot of graphs, but this is the one that shows the circle and the arrows going both ways. I think one thing that we tend to do is try to find one group to blame. And if we work together, what we need to find out is what are all the dimensions, where are all the causes, and how can we collaborate to solve this very important issue in our society. It doesn't come from just one piece of this equation, so that's something else we really need to be working on. So I want to tell you a little bit about what we're doing in mutually advancing healthcare. So embracing the digital health revolution, we're going through many of the same challenges and opportunities that you are in this exponentially changing world. And it's exciting, isn't it? And it doesn't happen overnight, but it's really exciting. And so we're looking for OnStar for the body in animals as well as in people. We aren't looking for people, you are, but we're looking for that. And so the question asked is, should there be an X Prize for animals? And I would contend there should. And this is an example. Again, at A&M, we have a thing called Aggies Invent, where it's a souped-up hackathon, and students come together, and they're given a problem, and they try to solve it. And they do this in 48 hours. These are two Texas A&M students, and they came up with sky paws, and they actually won the competition, have won several pitches since then. And this is a wireless monitor using Bluetooth that monitors a lot of the health parameters. And these are current students. One's an undergraduate, one's a veterinary student, and they're actually have investors, and they're going to try to go to market with this. So we're pretty excited about that. And I'll tell you that the more diverse the teams in these students, the more creative the solution. Very exciting. So if we have all veterinary students, if we have all medical students, if we have all engineering students, it's when you get that mix that you really get the creative solution. So we love that too. Now, there are a lot of people looking at this space. And if you look at the worldwide venture investments in pet-related technology startups, it is really going high. And there are over 900 startups in pets today. So this is an opportunity for startups as well. And then you can extrapolate to people. And it's sometimes you can move the needle farther forward in a pet than you can in a person because of a lot of the complications in doing human research. So as a result of that, we have a lot of devices coming out that just like on the human side, we're not there yet on all of them, but there are a lot of them coming out. There are a lot of them that mainly to track where they are and activity monitors. And here are some examples of that. These are mainly trackers and activity monitors. There are a lot of them coming out. Here are more. The Pit Pat also links to insurance, and so you get lower insurance rates. They're trying to add health parameters in some of these. And then here's a dermatology score, so it can actually measure scratching, so you get a just through their actions and motion, you get a dermatology score from that. I love this one. Here's ways that you can play with your animal from afar. You can talk to your animal on a screen. Here's a fit bark instead of a fit bit. And the one I love the most is more than a wolf, and it's interspecies communication. Now, we all laugh about that, but we now can do functional MRI in dogs, and you teach them to lie still, and then you do things in front of them that they react to, and you can measure the changes through functional MRI. So interspecies communication is not out of the question yet. Hang on to it for a while. All right, another one is what we do with cattle. Cattle, we have these monitors that can tell reproductive strategies. They can tell by the activity and by the GI motility and by their eating patterns when they're in heat, and that's really important in animals. And you can tell their health monitoring, and you can monitor the whole herd. And here, using these monitoring devices, we can tell 3 days before you can tell by routine means that they're sick, that they're going to be sick. So we can intervene much earlier and keep them healthier. So very exciting. Same thing is, here's an AI stethoscope that grades lung sounds for us in cattle. Pneumonia is a big problem in cattle. Horses, same thing. We can monitor them in many ways. There's a leg wrap that gives you parameters that are supposed to be as accurate as invasive techniques. Also watching them at night. There are many different things that we can do. The equine GI tract is a little hard to do a colonoscopy. It takes a 3-meter endoscope to do a gastroscopy, but their intestinal tract is very torturous. But here's a group that's come up with the pill that can visualize all the way through. So very exciting works that's paralleling some of the things that you're doing. Now, we also are making a big foray into veterinary telemedicine. We're not there yet, but this is a natural evolution of healthcare in the digital world in both human and veterinary medicine. And so here's what I was using today with my dog. It's like Snapchat from the operating room. It's an app called Ease where you can communicate back with the owner about their animal. We were the first veterinary school to use this, and our clients are really loving it. I loved it today in the audience. We hired the first telemedicine veterinarian in academic setting in the country, and we're really proud about that, and she's building out that program. We've created something called Virtual Vet, and we're still developing it. We're starting with dermatology referrals, and we're going to keep expanding, and we're going to foray, and we have the ability to do this now of referral ultrasound so that we can work with a referring veterinarian from home. So veterinary telemedicine, all the same things that you have in human medicine, we just are trying to move ahead in this area because we think it's really important. And as a result of that, a lot of telehealth providers are emerging on the scene. Here's one that's comprehensive. It does not only telemedicine, but makes appointments remotely and all the different ways. So there are a lot of different apps that are coming out for us. Now, here's the other thing. Tremendous parallel with human medicine, remote care, rural communities. We have a hard time getting veterinarians in rural communities, just like there's a problem in getting physicians in rural communities. We think that telehealth is an answer to that. So here's where we are now. I think many of you have seen this, but the iPhone will see you now. We're all going to these apps in both human and veterinary medicine, and it's a real fun time. So why is this so important? This is what our clients are going to demand. This is what the patients are going to demand. And in human medicine, there are people who have said, I will leave my doctor if this doctor doesn't offer that. And the same thing's going to be true of veterinary medicine. And we also need to be careful that people outside of the professions don't become the healthcare providers that that we need to keep it within. We have the same issue with Amazon trying to disrupt healthcare. They're making a foray. They see the investment that's being made in pets, and they're following it. And so we don't have Dr. Alexa yet in veterinary medicine. We will soon. But we do have Ask My Pet Doc, which is artificial intelligent algorithms. And we also have AI diagnostics will predict when an animal is going to get renal disease. And we have vetology, which is AI diagnostics in veterinary medicine and radiography. We've got AI and intelligent stethoscopes. Here's one more. We have a diagnostic imaging and cancer treatment center that is really fantastic. There are people that tell us that this equipment is better than some human hospitals, not all certainly, but some. And we always tell people that we can image anything we can stuff in that hole. And kind of, I don't say it exactly like that, but I could. But we do. We image a lot of different animals, and it's a very exciting thing to do because we don't have a roadmap in doing that. We have to make it up as we go or find it out. And so through using dachshunds, we have actually customized MRI sequences that are now being used in pediatric patients, which allows higher resolution and better diagnostic power than using the same thing as for an adult human. And here's another one. Cat kit, which is the first, it's base paws, it's for genetic testing for disease in cats. We know CRISPR and gene editing. We are gene editing in horses genetic disorders. We're doing things like pigs that are resistant to diseases, cattle that are resistant, all sorts of things we're doing with gene editing, just like you are, just like you. I saw it this morning. Walmart, pet care is in Walmart now. Uber Health, guess what? Uber Pet, same thing. So we're undergoing the same thing. So embracing this digital revolution is really important for all of us, and I think we can help each other out. And I wanted to tell you, as I close, one case that's kind of fun too. I love this. First do no harm, after that go nuts. And so here was a case of a woman who had this dog that she loved. He was 2 years old, and he ended up showing neurologic signs and had a multilobular bone tumor. And everybody told her to put this dog down. You couldn't save this dog. Well, we took the dog and we 3D printed a skull for this dog. And here is the dog now. It's now a service dog. And so exciting things. All of us are just trying to be creative, depending on what comes up in front of us. How many of you get to do a humeral fracture repair in a polar bear, a 500-pound animal that has its own challenges, not only in handling it, but also 500 pounds of torque on a device? And then first, spinal tap on a bottlenose dolphin. Just kind of fun things that we get to do. But I think veterinary healthcare has never been better. human health care has never been better. And all of us, if we're going to thrive, not just survive, we are going to have to take care of the client and what the client, customer, patient wants. And so same topics, we could put veterinary instead of human, and we would have the same issues. And I think in the next decades, human and veterinary care is going to be barely recognizable. But this is our biggest issue. This is our biggest issue for all of us moving forward. No thanks, we're too busy. We like the way we do it. We don't have time for that. So if human and veterinary medicine work together, we're going to make global health all the better. Saw this in the airport, had to take a picture of it. I don't remember your name. You must not have a dog. So with that, this was just meant to be a teaser, but we are facing the same issues, and we have got to work together for solutions for all of us. So thank you very much. Yeah.
Yeah. One question.
Yeah, question.
Fantastic. Pet bit, all these sorts of things. What can folks do here who are in the traditional medical world to actually make that convergence collaboration happen?
Well, I think one thing is, as we get more and more people investing, as we're going to be investing, either an investment company is going to invest in veterinary and human at the same time, or if we have something where somebody's investing in the veterinary space, we have to share those results, and vice versa. So it's really all about sharing what we're coming up with, I think. And then, of course, it's the teams again. It's the interdisciplinary, interprofessional teams that are going to come up with these creative solutions for all of us. So rather than coming up with solutions where we just see our work as it always is, we can be broadened so much by seeing the perspective of others. And I think that is the answer.
Great. Thank you, Dean Green.
All right. Thanks. Thank you.
All right. Fantastic.